In addition to the things that I've boasted about her in our various communications to you, I also learned when chatting with her that she played in high school, she played Eliza Doolittle in My Fair Lady. So unexpected treasure everywhere. Welcome to Backstage.
Paula, thank you so much. It's truly a joy to be here. I'm just excited that everyone is here and that we're kicking off this series. Looks like there's going to be some really great conversations going forward and just this amazing legacy of theater in Antioch.
Were there experiences growing up of theater that led you into this field?
Well, it's interesting. My first role was Anna in The King and I in kindergarten, and I wet my pants on stage. So that's how I kicked off my interest in theater. And in high school, I had a fantastic, I was really behind the scenes for most of high school. I painted scenery. I was really a visual arts person. But got the bug in high school, was in the chorus. We did 5 shows a year in my high school in Oceanside, Long Island. And then in my senior year, I got to play Eliza Doolittle, and that was kind of it, you know? There were a number of experiences I had before Antioch.
How did you get to Antioch? What brought you?
So in the theater program at my high school, there was a guy named Alan Siege, who was my classmate at Oceanside. And he came back he was working for Niccolo Marionettes on co-op. And he was a year ahead of me. And I don't know if anybody remembers, but Niccolo Marionettes was a kind of standard co-op job for at Antioch. And it was this amazing job where you did, you know, six days a week, 3 shows a day, touring all over. I played Wendy. I took the job later, and I played Wendy and all the Little Lost Boys and Peter Pan as marionettes. So it was wonderful training. So Alan told me about it, and that was the year before. It was the year of the strike, 1973. Mm-hmm. I applied, and I waited to hear if the college was going to open, and 2 weeks after I graduated high school, I showed up at Antioch the first term after it opened after the strike. So it was a remarkable time to be there. And of course, Downing Kless was professor there, and Meredith Dallas was still teaching, and Paul was occasionally teaching. So it was a wonderful group, and the whole Black theater wing was there, Esteban Vega and Dwayne Jones. So it was a really remarkable time, even in the midst of all of the turmoil, you know.
Well, let's get to some of your productions. I'd like you to talk first, just indulge me by talking about your solo performance in Cincinnati with your dog Twigs.
So yeah, I started making solos in 1984, and they've often been autobiographical. And I had a little dog named Twigs that an Antioch student had given me, and she was a kind of mutt dog. My husband called her a dog with no qualities. But she was a really remarkable little dog, and I made a dog act with her, really where I wore her like a hat. And I used her like a puppet. And then she just wandered into the audience while I talked to the audience. And at the end, she jumped for a stick, you know. And it was a lot of fun. I actually did it also at Dixon Place in New York City, in Yellow Springs and various places. And so she got to travel with me. She was a wonderful animal. She also played Toto in the Yellow Springs High School version of The Wizard of Oz. She had her career.
Terrific.
Yeah. She was barking at bats at the Foundry Theater. So the performances were a little bit interesting for the high schools.
Yeah. Dealing with animals in live theater, especially outdoors, is a challenge. I know during the Shakespeare Festival, the actors were able to make use of anything that came their way.
Right.
So let's get to some of your other productions. So can you talk about what the idea behind this was and how you went about creating a production out of it.
This is an image from a play called Poliver that I did with Peggy Pettit in 1987. And it underlines, I just want to underline that through my whole adult career in theater, you know, Antioch has threaded through and continues to thread through to this day with the people that I collaborate with and the kind of kindred spirits that I find in downtown theater. So Peggy, I was really interested in making a play about racism and the history of kind of white supremacy and colonialism in America. In the late 80s, there was a lot going on in New York City at the time, a lot of very disturbing racial incidents out in the boroughs and with the police. And I wanted to talk about it. And as I started writing, I realized I really wanted to work with an African-American actor, preferably another woman. And Peggy, I knew from a wonderful play that Downing Cleff directed, Show Me a Good Loser and I'll Show You a Loser, and that I had seen her in at Antioch. And I contacted her. She was a storyteller performer in New York City doing solos, and had also started the film called Black Girl. She's a remarkable writer, performer. And
she's an Antioch graduate too.
And she's an Antioch graduate, right. Yeah. And we share the same birthday, February 8th. We were both raised by our grandparents. You know, we had a lot of resonance in our lives together. And she and I collaborated on a play that was about South Africa, but we sort of superimposed this college friendship, a fictional but sometimes real college friendship, on the story of South Africa and America's attitudes towards South African apartheid. So, and she did a fantastic monologue in this play about the Black dorm at Antioch.
Mm-hmm.
That was really incredible. So she and I collaborated, and we presented this at PS 122 in New York City and at the Women Against Racism conference at University of Iowa. And it was a really rewarding and wonderful experience to work with her.
It's a stunning picture.
Yeah, you can see I'm dressed like a big game hunter. And I kept going with this idea of whiteness and white kind of attitudes in this play called White Man Fever. And this was directed by another Antiochian, Lizzie Olesker, who was my classmate at Antioch. And it examines this idea of white man fever, this idea of having to conquer. And so this first one is an image of me in the first one. It was a trilogy. White man was a club act by a singer, kind of Peggy Lee-esque Carol Baker movie star character. And the third part of the trilogy, Fever, was a study of Admiral Perry and his conquering of the North Pole. Lizzie Olesker is a fantastic director, playwright, dramaturg, and I've worked with her on my solo works several times. And she helped me to craft the material. So I work with these big themes and then try to specify and write. I was also working with a composer on this piece named Neil Kirkwood, who is a jazz musician. And again, really performed this a lot on tour at Actors Theater Louisville and their Flying Solo Festival in Milwaukee, Minneapolis, and at St. Mark's Dance Space. I got to do this play a lot, and this was in 1990.
And what animal are you eating in this photo?
A lion, of course.
And then I see your other prey in the foreground.
Yes, I'm eating a lion. Yeah.
Okay, let's go on to the next slide.
Yeah, this piece was later. This was in 1997, and this piece is called Interfacing Joan. And I began writing this. It was about Joan of Arc, but also about the idea of hearing voices and activism in the digital age, but also historically, looking at the figure of Joan of Arc as a kind of archetype that's been co-opted by different sides, but also a kind of archetype for me to channel in terms of, you know, how do I activate myself in the world to make a difference? And I worked on this with Ping Chong. We got a National Endowment for the Art Collaborative Artist Fellowship to do this, and I worked on it with him for about a year. He directed it. And again, got to present this, you know, around, actually I went to the International Theater Festival in El Salvador, and Victor Garcia's wife, Irendira Garcia, helped me to translate a lot of this play into Spanish so I could perform it in Spanish. I was at Antioch at the time, or just arrived. I came back to teach in 94, and it was influenced a lot by watching how students were trying to grapple with what does it mean to be an activist? What does it mean to try to make a difference? It was, you know, a meditation really on that. Although it used the narrative of Joan of Arc as the kind of structural component of the
And what was the audio that is represented by the boombox?
Yeah, there were actually, I don't know if people remember, well, you know, of course, Steve Schwerner, one of the pieces of audio, there were a number of pieces of audio. Steve Schwerner wrote a beautiful set of instructions for being in a demonstration. And I recorded that, and I played that at one point. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this play was a really important one for me, just in terms of, again, though it wasn't autobiographical, it was a deeper investigation of what I was experiencing at the time, again, in terms of how to be an activist and how to make a difference in the world.
The way you present your face and the costuming that you choose is really different from one play to the next.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's a real transformation. And I guess very important to performance.
Yeah, for me, each of these things were a world that I got into and investigated. And each one was, I hope, was really different. And I worked with a director named Ralph Lee years ago, and he was a mask maker. And he always talked about material as, you know, the mask, he would say, it wants to have a big nose. It wants to have some fuzzy eyebrows. It wants, you know, little lips. And I feel like that about any work that you engage with. It wants to be a certain way. And it's not Aristotelian, and it's not that unity of time, place, you know, event. It's actually, I consider myself a postmodern artist. A lot of my work is associative. It's nonlinear. It is not a story told from beginning to end in a chronological way necessarily. It's juxtapositional, and it wants to be, you know, each theme wants you to do something different with it. So that's kind of how I've thought of my work. So this is another play that I worked with Lizzie Olesker on. It's called The House of the Mighty Mother That Travels Across the Sky. And it was really very autobiographical. Although I didn't play myself, I played a character who was based on a kind of Humphrey Bogart-esque investigator named Moon Muldoon. And she was trying to solve the mystery of a missing mother. And the picture of the house on the desk is an actual model of where I grew up in Brooklyn. And we performed this at Dance Theater Workshop in 1992. And I took it also to Minneapolis and a couple of other places. But yeah, this was a fun show. Again, I work with Neil Kirkwood. I always often like to use live music. And it was another time when Lizzie really helped me to craft the story. I wanted to also underline that this was very influenced by reading Jung, Carl Jung, and the idea of the house as a psyche. Because she's investigating this house, she goes through all the rooms of the house and finds a different mother in each room. Mm. So she finds the blessed mother in the backyard amidst the washing. She finds this high school kid who was my mother up in a bedroom. She finds my grandmother in the sewing room. Every room has a different mother. And in the basement, she finds a dead mother. So, you know, it's kind of a, as I look back on some of these works and on my recent, more recent work as a therapist, reading Carl Jung and being influenced by his work and his ideas as an artist brought me into an interest in doing therapy later on.
Mm-hmm. Next slide.
We just did this show, it's called The Lemon Girls, and it was a show that was written by Ellen Maddow with music composed by her and directed by Paul Zimmet of the Talking Band. My time after Antioch as a student was with Otrabanda Company, and then we all moved to New York City. And I was fortunate to be part of these different collectives, Ping Chong and Company and the Talking Band and Otrabanda, over the years. My artistic home was at La Mama, and that's where this show was done this past winter as part of the 60th anniversary of La Mama. And the cast was Lizzie Olesker from the left, Ellen Maddow, Petrina Murray, myself, and Jack Weatherall, who are Talking Band members. But the show was about four women who are old friends from grammar school who get recruited by Jack's character to be in a dance performance at a community center. Mm-hmm. And in the course of the play, you come to find out that there's a fifth friend who'd recently passed away. And they were in a lot of denial and pain about her loss. And in the course of making the dance performance, they kind of come to terms with grieving her. And it's a beautiful play that Ellen wrote about friendship and aging and death and art. Yeah, pretty good subjects, I think.
What dance, how did you dance in it? How did people dance?
Well, we did these, it was really wonderful how the play was constructed because the rehearsals, you know, the scenes were taking place inside a rehearsal studio, that was the cafe where we would return, but the rest of the stage was like the rehearsal studio where we were making the dances. So you would watch us rehearsing these dances, and then at the end we did a medley of all these different kinds of styles, Bob Fosse, disco. And I got to do a dream ballet with Jack, which is the next slide. And that was a wonderful experience to do this dream ballet. So, you know, in the course of it, the women are, we worked with a wonderful choreographer, and he really made us look better than we probably would have without him, for sure. And he made these fantastic dances. This is a scene from The Lemon Girls, and it's the beginning of the dream ballet. My character has discovered Florence Foster Jenkins, and she begins to doubt that perhaps this whole thing is to just make fun of them as aging women. And in the course of storming out of the rehearsals, she sits on a bench and falls asleep and has this revelation about dance and art and comes back to finish.
It's a stunning image.
Yeah.
And the lighting is fantastic too.
Yeah, beautiful, yeah. So just going back, you know, I want to thread another theme through here of collaboration, which has been such an important value that I learned at Antioch, that I really tried to teach my students. I think in theater and performance, that ability to work in a group, to work with other people, to be completely open and in exchange with other artists is really one of the beauties of theater. And so this piece was called The Sympathy of All Things. And I had written a script based on Jung's writings that and on the idea of active imagination. And I brought it to my former student, Selena Loomis, who I had, you know, worked with at Antioch in the new Antioch. And they said, I'm not feeling the script. let's just see what happens. And I was like, great. So we used some of my script, we wrote new material, and Selena proposed that we build these houses out of fabric and animate them. And they became a central component. And we each sewed our own house, and they became a central component of the piece, which we performed at Agraria in outside of Yellow Springs, in their barn and in the environs. So it was an environmentally staged piece that was really about kind of the vanishing world, you know, the vanishing natural world in a way, and our interconnection to it.
Can you explain Agraria, what Agraria is?
Agraria, Center for Regenerative Practices, it's an organization that's outside of Yellow Springs. It was part of Community Solutions. I'm not sure of the entire history of it, but it's a wonderful place that's just outside of town. They have a big barn. They do a lot of experimentation with different kinds of environmental practices, a lot of education, a lot of community organizing around environmental action and zero footprint, you know, responsible cultivation of the land and stewardship. Mm-hmm. And they've been out there probably, well, gosh, I don't know, 6-7 years now maybe. And they have a beautiful old barn in there and gardens outside. Mm-hmm. So I thought it would be interesting to do this piece there. And I had approached them, and Selena's partner, Gabby, had also worked there. So it was really a wonderful connection. And this is another image from that piece, Selena and I, kind of invoking and inviting the audience to, we separated and each did a solo outside. I burned old writings, and Selena was really interested in lawns and how the whole idea of a lawn was sort of interrogating this idea of a lawn. And then we had the houses, and then we paraded into the barn and started the piece. But when I was teaching at Antioch and the kinds of plays I made, it's funny with this presentation, kind of chose to talk about my own work more than what I did, but I did teach at Antioch for, gosh, almost 25 years, and, you know, made a lot of different kinds of work, always with the idea that, you know, the students and I were, it was more like an apprenticeship model. It was more about collaborating. It had the spirit of it wants to be. So sometimes students didn't understand me, like, she's just not authoritative enough. You know, she's a director like we had in high school, but my high school director wasn't like that. And certainly as I studied in drama school, and, you know, what I responded to was not the sort of shaming authoritarian director, but rather the model of a director that is compassionate and elicits from the actor their best work. Mm-hmm. And that's what I experienced at Antioch with Downing. I'm going to get a little choked up with Dal, Meredith Dallas. And what I observed there, you know, as a student, that value of that human value of the individual and giving voice artistically inside the work to each person. So, yeah. So anyway, it was a joy to work with Selena on this. And it's, you know, it was generally a joy to work with all the students I ever worked with at Antioch.
I think when we chatted, you told me that being part of Otra Banda had sort of cemented the idea of collective theater.
Yeah, it was interesting about Otra Banda because while we didn't do overtly political theater, we certainly lived in a political way by, you know, being a collective, by floating down the Mississippi rather than, you know, on a raft, and really highlighting the river. In those small communities along the river.
For people who don't know, Otra Banda was a company that formed at Antioch and that conceived this idea sort of from Huck Finn, of going down the Mississippi River in a raft. And I think they did it for how many years?
The company did it for 10 years all told. And it was funded by the National Endowment for the Arts Expansion Arts Program, which was killed by Reagan. So it was, you know, from the early 70s to the mid 80s. It was an amazing achievement. And Peter Ekstrom and I were in a show together. A great way to cut your teeth. It was my first professional job in the theater.
Did you ever have any close calls on the river?
You know, there were a couple of, there was a big storm that came in one day, and we got very disoriented out in the middle of the river, and the coolers started, the raft was a pontoon raft, 16 feet long. And there were these huge barges, but we were vigilant in the midst of our, in the midst of our kind of hippie party haze. So we always had a cappy. We always had somebody who was looking out with the river charts, making sure we were, you know, safe.
Cool.
Yeah.
So great. We'll probably have Otra Banda, if they agree, to do one of these in the coming year.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Wonderful stories.
Yeah. Roger Babb actually did a presentation with Susan in 2016 at Antioch when we had theater as a theme.
So this, we're skipping around a little in time, but about 5 years ago, Ellen Maddow had come to town to do some work with my husband, John Fleming's theater company, YSKP, Yellow Springs Kids Playhouse. I don't know if people are aware, but for 20 years at the college, we hosted a thing called Yellow Springs Kids Playhouse every summer. And John was the director, and he directed an original musical with children every summer in the amphitheater for 20 years. And Ellen had come to compose music for a play, and we started talking about working together. And we got fascinated with the painter James Ensor. And there was one painting in particular called Scandalized Masks. And my character with the striped skirt and the little pointy hat, and Ellen's character are actually these in this painting. The woman is the striped skirt character is in a doorway with a candle, and Ellen's character is sort of sitting at a table. And it's a really haunting image, and as are all of his paintings, really amazing. I had seen a retrospective. So Ellen and I collaborated in a really unusual way. We would set a date, and like a Friday afternoon from 3 to 5, we would both look at the same James Ensor painting, and we would write for 2 hours and send each other what we wrote. Dialogue. It was very open-ended. We decided on these characters as kind of the basis of the play, but then these characters also had kind of contemporary counterpoints that were based on Broad City, the two women in Broad City. So these very youthful, very boisterous, irreverent younger characters. And we sort of went between those two things about, and so it became about, it was also a play about friendship and aging and art. And we were also at the time reading Alana Ferrante's My Brilliant Friend. So thinking a lot about this idea of frenemies as well. This was a really wonderful play for, you know, to perform, and it was very different. It was very broad acting, and I made the masks and costumes. Ellen composed the music. We collaborated on the set, and Paul Zimmet from the Talking Band directed it. And we did.
I think there's one more slide of.
Yeah, one more slide of Skirt and Nozzle. Yeah. Yeah. So it had, you know, it had live music. Ellen, I love to sing. And Ellen and I, we like to sing together. So there were songs in this that
a question from Robert Goldsmith. Robert, if you could unmute yourself.
Thanks, Jesse. I'm unmuted. You can hear me, yes? Louise, I have a question regarding your theatrical pieces that you wrote and or as well your the pieces that you performed in. Over the course of your career, is there a theme or direction that you were going in rather than just being completely random in terms of just going from one thing to another? Could you elaborate on that?
That's a really great question, Robert. Yeah, it feels, you know, it's, as I said, my approach in making solos was to engage big themes and to find the personal in and the sort of specific in the larger general theme. You know, when I worked with Ping Chong and Company, his theme was the other, the whole idea of the other. And for years, I mean, I worked with him for 11 years, and I think it permeated into some of the way that I thought about the work I was doing on my own. It's really about a kind of reverence and respect for interior life, for the inner life, for the inner life of the individual. I think that that, if there was anything, and the idea of the integrity of that inside of a character or inside of a story, right? The need for it to be seen, the need to be told, and bearing witness to what is actually happening inside a person. That, I guess, if I were to find anything that could knit all this randomness together, I think that's what it would be. Again, just thinking about where I'm at now with this idea of the psyche. My first piece was called Small White House, and it was about wanting a past that was not my own in a little white house, as opposed to where I grew up, and going into the little white house. And I would say that, honestly, that's kind of like, that's it right there. You know, sort of like that, and maybe another thing is longing.
I want to tell us about Dorothy Lane, which also kind of represents your move into therapy.
Yeah.
How did that move come about?
Well, when the college closed, when the college was in trouble, say, the last few years before it closed, I decided to go back to graduate school and, you know, and study counseling, psychotherapy counseling, mental health counseling. And it was very influenced by Meredith Dallas, who was, I had been in his class as a student in his thesis performance for his thesis at Union Institute, his dissertation at Union Institute in Gestalt Therapy. So Dorothy Lane, I worked in on a assertive community treatment team in Dayton for a year with 35 people with schizophrenia, visiting them in their homes. Mm-hmm. And that was my first job in community mental health. And it was eye-opening and it was challenging. And it was
also, you had 35 clients?
The team had 35 clients. I was part of a team. The idea was you did try to see everybody every week if you could. And sometimes people, you didn't because they were either in hospital or they disappeared for a little bit. But the idea was trying to keep people in the community. And I started doing some writing thinking this was going to be a book of nonfiction. And I wrote it and worked on it on and off for 10 years. And in 2017, I started to talk to Lizzie Olesker about the idea of making it a performance instead of a book. I also had taken a lot of photographs in Dayton, not of people, but of places in Dayton. I mean, Dayton is a city that has had a lot of duress and has been under a lot of challenge. And I started to really see the geography of Dayton, especially this was 2008. So we're talking, recession, gas prices are like $5 a gallon. We're talking big GM plant laid off all its workers. You know, Dayton lost a lot of, you know, financial stability in 2008. The college closed. I mean, so, you know, it was a moment that was sort of resonating also with these people who were really under a lot of challenge and very misunderstood. So, I struggled in writing it. I struggled with not really respecting, not caricaturing people. That was one thing. And the other was, what's my story inside of it? How much do I tell my story or not? And those questions I really had to grapple with. That's why it took so long to write.
My favorite scene is where you're sitting in your car eating lunch.
Yeah.
It's just so something that is familiar to all of us, that period in a job when you're, you know, you're worn out, but you know you have this job to do.
Yeah.
You just want to take a minute for yourself. And there you are, chomping on your sandwich. I love it.
That was Lizzie's inspiration. And it was very much, I can remember days like that, sitting in my car, just, there was a way in which I just, my car became a kind of safe haven.
Yeah, right. Now, was there any problem in representing your clients?
I determined that it was probably a good idea for me to go talk to a lawyer. To make sure that because I am a licensed therapist and I didn't want to lose my license over this. Mm. I didn't want to breach confidentiality, which is, of course, you know, ethically and legally really a key factor of my work. So I went to a lawyer and he looked at the script, and I had already changed everybody's name. I changed their location. I had talked about them in terms of like Wilmington Pike. You know, I named the street names really. I gave them different names, different gender, a couple of times. And he said, well, did this person say this phrase? Their language was so amazing. You know, did this person say this phrase? And I said, yes. And he said, you can't put that in there.
Hmm.
So I had to go back and rewrite the whole thing. Hmm. The only thing I didn't change was I had a supervisor. And they kept saying to me, you have to tell the clients, poor planning on your part doesn't make it a crisis for me. And that was such a stunning line coming, you know, here we are talking about people with thought disorders and a really difficult, you know, ability. They had no very hard time with executive function. And he's telling me I'm supposed to say that to them. I had to keep it in the play. It was a way of talking about how the system fails folks. During that year, Good Samaritan Hospital was shut down in Dayton. And that was really disturbing to me because it was in a largely African-American part of the city. And what, you know, we see this everywhere now, these hospitals that are in urban environments that put satellites out in the suburbs and close the hospital in the city. And that's exactly what happened. And my program began because they had closed another. They had closed another. I didn't put this in the play, but they had closed another program. Antioch was in crisis. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was an interesting. Yeah.
So that was in crisis, and Antioch Nonstop came out of that, which was
formal experimentation.
It was kind of Antioch
is political in the sense that you're disrupting
a space
what the expectations
and
are.
A group
and also,
of faculty.
When you have more open systems of meaning,
students,
you're inviting the audience
staff
to have a more active
from
participation
Antioch
in meaning
and
making.
Townspeople
you're not telling
participated
them what you mean.
In
yeah.
this.
You're really
this
co-creating
thing.
It in the moment, and they bring this.
Yeah, it was a pretty amazing
it.
And to me. I think that's deeply political model.
It's about what democracy is, right? It's like
you know
how
there
we,
was a.
How
a group,
we, you know,
a collective of people, faculty,
with each other.
Really kept it going. Of course, the alumni were generous.
Yeah, I would say that
really floated that project.
That art is political for sure,
deck.
Of course.
But,
gosh, I didn't realize how much
really
time has gone
thing.
By.
Yeah, we should probably move
faculty,
to,
as you said, Paul.
Yeah, to
members.
To and for me,
yeah.
it's an artistic home.
Well, I'll just end with. Something that another graduate of Antioch,
you know,
who just got a Tony Award,
solos there,
said,
also taught a mask making
keep making weird art.
Mm. Yeah, that was Deirdre O'Connell.
Saw some incredible
yeah.
stuff.
Won a Tony for
Chris Hill,
Dana
and
H. on Broadway.
Springer.
Amazing.
Artist,
Dan Eggleston.
Wonderful.
Colleague
Bob Devine.
Yeah, I went
so
to
let's
one
open
of Bob
it up.
Devine's lectures. To everybody.
I
still have the handouts. I think they're... You know, and start getting some questions too thick. I think there were some in the chat. Barry,
yeah.
is that right?
And
are you going to take over now?
No questions
yes.
as such. Barbara Solo says she's sorry to have to hop off early. Thank you for hosting this conversation. I have been inspired by Louise since I was a student at Antioch.
The people who were trying to get
more
Antioch
art and activism.
Feet. didn't really use
right.
nonstop.
I want to mention that on this call are
and one of the tragedies,
Neela Miller of Antioch,
Stephen Hendrickson,
Peter Ekstrom, most of the faculty,
and Robin Rice,
been there and had worked,
all of whom,
you know,
be
for pitiful wages
in the
so
conversations
and
that are to come.
And exhausted.
The only person who isn't here
we're
is
not
Scott
rehired.
Sanders, who's the
and so that
curator
is,
of Antiochiana.
And
a
has
bitter
pills
that many of us carry
and that he's going to share
to
this day.
Robin Rice wants to speak.
So can art be political? I guess.
Yeah,
from what you
I just
said,
want to say I
yes, it can.
I
yes, it is.
Was working on the theater building at Antioch. This
yes,
must have
is.
Been the early 90s. Louise, you'll tell me what year
too,
it was.
You know, the idea
I was with
the status
work
quo.
Project.
Does it
and
support the status
Louise
quo?
Louise came
or does
in
it challenge
and
the status
she
quo?
Didn't work there yet.
And
she
it,
was just visiting the place
quo?
With
and
her family.
Me, you know,
and she said she wasn't sure if she really wanted to drag her family out to live in Yellow Springs. She really liked the job offer, but she was mulling it over.
Uh-huh.
And I just want to say, boy, are we ever glad that you mulled the right way.
Well, it was, thanks, Robin. Well, it's funny because I was working there already, but I was only on a 6-month contract.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I had taken over from Martin Warman. Who had
oh yes, yes. We were fixing the dance space in.
That's right. We were fixing the dance space, and Martin was a fantastic. You know, he was one of the. Oh my gosh, my brain. But anyway, he was an amazing performer and came out of Richard Schechner's performance program, and he passed away. So I came in for 6 months, and then I applied for the job. And got it. But I wasn't sure because it was a big switch from New York City and I had 2 small children and my husband, John Fleming, and thankfully he agreed to stay and it was a really good thing and has been a really good thing.
I think we need to wrap up. Oh yes, Sarah Albertson.
Hi, this is wonderful, just wonderful. I'm looking for people that were in my years and haven't seen them yet, but wow, I'm so impressed with all that's happened at Antioch. I graduated in 68 and I was just curious, you mentioned the Black Theater Wing and could you just talk a little about how you or Antioch brought together the diversity within the student population in theater?
Well, it's, you know, actually Downing might be a better person to answer this question because I just sort of walked into it and experienced it more as a student back in the 70s. And I don't know how it all came about. I think Dow might have had something to do with it. Also, I know that, you know, Paula's mom was very dedicated to, you know, what we call inclusion, but, you know, people being that the college had, you know, back in the day that was called like cultural plurality. But my experience was working as a technician in different ways, helping with lighting, doing stage management for productions that Esteban Vega and Dwayne Jones directed that had all Black casts.
I was also thinking of during the time you were teaching.
Oh,
to
yeah.
Not very specifically that group.
Oh, well, during the time I was teaching, I met through my student, Bianca Pettis, I met a fantastic playwright named Carlisle Brown. And she had been on co-op at the Minneapolis Playwrights Center. And she told me about Carlisle, and Carlisle was having a residency at OSU, James Thurber House. And we met, and he ended up coming every fall being playwright in residence for 4 years. He just recently won the William Inge Award. His plays are really well known, and he's a remarkable writer who, you know, really kind of reinvigorates Black history and, you know, has written The African Company Presents Richard III and another play premiered at our place called The Big Blue Nail that went on to La Jolla and all other kinds of places. And We're still friends, and he was a remarkable writer. And so, yeah, we also got a grant at one point early in the 90s from the Ford Foundation called the Cultural Diversity Campus Resource Initiative. And that really prompted us to work closely with a group in town that was doing a blues fest. So we hosted a blues fest in the amphitheater every year. That was a town gown kind of thing. It was kind of like the equivalent of the Shakespeare in a way, although it was very, very, very different in that the town was so involved. Okay. And we weren't really producing it necessarily, but we did do some outdoor productions during the 90s, which included town folks. So as a value, and then of course in the new Antioch, we had a wonderful African-American Black feminist performance artist named Gabrielle Seville, who was hired as the first performance professor. And she is remarkable and is now at CalArts. She was like the Pied Piper. I mean, the students just adored her, and she's a remarkable artist and writer and person. So I think over the years that value has tried to, we've tried to kind of keep that in the foreground as much as possible.
Well, I think we'll say goodbye.
Thank you so much.
Keep making weird art.
Thank you so much, Paula, Barry, Susan, Migua, who's not here. Thanks to everybody who came. So grateful.